just wanted to mention briefly paper that was publicly advertised at the Gazette last week on black holes, and it has to do with the significance of black holes for life. You might think that black holes are very hazardous for life because they emit X-rays and radiation. And indeed, the inner parts of galaxies are dangerous. One can show that the stars with habitable planets around them that are within a kiloparsec or so from thousands of light years from the central black hole would get
hit. I think it's Shep, I'm not sure.
A significant fraction of the stars in the universe are not potentially habitable because they're too close. But the recent work that was mentioned in the Gazette, and if you have questions, you should ask John Forbes, he's here at Harvard. The recent work argues that you can actually turn planets that are not habitable to habitable. If you take a Neptune, a mini Neptune that has a gas envelope, the envelope would be ablated by the black hole, and it could turn into an Earth. So black holes have also a positive aspect to their existence. And they can promote life under some circumstances. But today we have, first of all, I wanted to mention that we have a bigger audience than usual, and that's a reflection of the quality of the talks today, that many more people than usual came to hear them. And we have two visitors, one, Alexei Baroni, over there, that came all the way from Finland, and is hoping to make it tomorrow evening back, although there is a storm coming. But we will be happy to keep you here. And the same holds for you, Franz. If you want to stay here, you don't need to go back. We'll be delighted. And we'll just inform Princeton that you are here. That's good. And Franz is actually the lead of a new initiative at Princeton that is focused on gravity. It's a new center that they're trying to establish, interdisciplinary between astronomy or astrophysics and physics and math. Yeah, so in a way, it's three quarters of the PhD. We don't have philosophy. So we are still unique in some sense. Laura.
Yeah, okay, so it's a great pleasure to introduce Franz Pretorius as our first speaker today. Professor Pretorius is a physics professor at Princeton University as is a leading expert in numerical solutions of general relativity. And his work includes studies of gravitational collapse, black hole mergers, cosmic singularity, higher dimensional gravity, and models of black hole evaporation, among others. And among his honor, Professor Pretorius was awarded a Sloan Research Fellowship and the Anisu Raman Prize for Computational Physics of the American Physical Society. So we are very glad to have him here today speak about coherent stacking of multiple gravitational wave units.
Thank you for the very generous introduction and offers. and the invitation to come up here. I haven't been to the Black Hole Initiative before, so it's nice to see what a vibrant place it is. And I think, like you said, like many places around the world are now wanting to get more involved in gravity. And surprisingly, Princeton hasn't been that involved. You know, since the great days of Wheeler and Dickey and all those people, and even Princeton now wants to get back into this gravity initiative. Okay, so I'm going to talk about coherent stacking of multiple gravitational wave events. So this is the outline of my talk, so I'll give you a little bit of a motivation for why we want to sort of add the data from multiple sources as opposed to just looking at various individual things, the things that LIGO is doing right now. And then I will discuss two applications, one to go after the quasi-normal ring-down modes of the remnant black hole in a binary black hole merger. And then also a little bit towards the end, and I might run out of time before I get to this, but also thinking about trying to stack binary neutron star merger signals to go after the post-merger signal of the merger of two binary neutron star systems. I mostly want to focus on binary black hole systems. And the reason is because of essentially the uniqueness properties in general relativity. A binary black hole system is a fantastic probe on fundamental physics, fundamental gravitational physics, and possibly even the environment because of these uniqueness properties, which I'm calling the final state conjecture, something that Penrose came up with or formulated back in the 60s. And so I want to spend a little bit of time sort of explaining and motivating this. And like what I'm going to say now, again, in this next 20 minutes, is nothing new. It's been known since the 60s and 70s. But those of you who have been sort of involving gravitational wave physics and the possibility of actually testing general relativity in the dynamical strong field, it's been proposed for since the 80s with Detweiler, so-called black hole spectroscopy. And the idea is, because of the so-called no-hair theorems, the quasi-normal ring-down modes of a black hole are essentially unique, and so that means you can test gravity by looking at the ring-down modes. On the other hand, I think that's quite a limited way of looking at the problem. And the real promise is the entire binary black hole merge, not just the ring down of the remnant. And it's really because of this final state conjecture that the fundamental hydrogen atom that we can use to probe strong field gravity or binary merges is not just ring down through black holes. Okay, so just a brief motivation on this, the stacking idea. So just like why would we want to take different events and add them together? The thinking ahead of what LIGO might see in the next 5-10 years and the various other detectors that are being built is that we could have a very rich data set available. There are going to be probably a few very loud events, but we expect perhaps tens to hundreds of binary black hole binary neutron star merger events. And in some cases, in particular, as quasi-normal modes of black holes, they're going to be common features to some of these merger events, but a lot of them, especially the next to leading order quasi-normal modes, are going to be very, very faint. So it might be, even with such a large data set, we might not see some of these faint events in any individual event by itself. But thanks to being this final state conjecture, we can perhaps combine multiple events to see a very weak feature that would not be observable in any one event by itself. And so that's sort of the motivation for trying to think of combining multiple events in some way. And basically, essentially, this is also not stacking is not a new idea. This is really from the astronomical community, and they've been doing it for decades. Sort of applied to gravitational waves, you want to think like, how can we possibly add gravitational waves? There are perhaps sort of two broad ways about doing it. One which I'm calling power stacking, where you don't really have information about the phase of the events that you want to add, so you're just adding excess power. And essentially, if everything else is equal, if you have n events, you might expect to gain a fourth root of n in signal to noise. The other way is if you do know something about the phase,
what's excess power?
So above the noise so there's a so LIGO has, if there's no gravitational wave, what it measures is essentially noise. And so there's a technique where they search for unmodeled signals. So the usual way that you might think about it is match filter. So you've got this template bank of known signals. You do match filtering to try to extract the very faint signal from the noise. But they've also got this search called this excess power search, where if there's an unmodeled gravitational wave, they can search for it in terms of just excess power above the noise floor. And that's
so also, just so I can think about it, what would be an example of a feature that could show up in different things and add? Like, usually the signals are totally different for each black hole. So what is an example of something that where you might expect?
Right, so that I'll show more explicitly with that. For example, the quasi-normal mode. So each black hole, depending on its mass and spin, will have a different characteristic frequency and decay time for, say, the dominant quasi-normal mode, but we know what they all are. So we actually can't just naively add the signals, we have to scale them. So we'll scale them in such a way that we align the frequencies of the quasi-normal modes, and then we can add them.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, I mean, in some sense, it's very much like what match filtering is doing with a single event, right? So if they say a merger waveform, each one of these cycles as being signal that they're actually coherently adding, but okay, it's now over time. Whereas if you had several bursts that happen separated in time, you could also add them, and if you could add them coherently, the noise is going to add, but the hypothesis is that the signal is going to add coherently, but the hypothesis is that the noise is not correlated, and so the noise is not going to add coherently, and so that's how you build up signal to noise, say with match filtering.
So you build up a signal, but what kind of information would that give you? Because I thought you'd really want to know about the quasi
associated
with particular black holes. So even if you could do that.
Right, so this would be, I'll sort of get more to the motivation, this would be to test, is relativity really describing what's happening in these mergers. Are they the Kerr black holes of relativity? Is the dynamics as described by general relativity? And so then the idea would be, sort of cutting to the punchline, is with GR, we're going to have a prediction for what, if we did add all of these events, they were all as described by GR, we should get the stacked signal should have a certain signal-to-noise ratio. It should be observed with a predictable signal-to-noise ratio. Just like a single in-spiral template, you know, the match filter signal-to-noise should be as predicted in general relativity. And that'll be sort of the starting point.
So it's really, okay, so it's by way of testing GR.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So just as to the, if you know the phase information, you can roughly think everything, all things being equal, if you add n events, you'll get a factor of a square root of n in signal to noise. Okay. So now I want to focus on binary black holes.
The other kind of, so the coherence stacking. So is that how they're helping to measure memory?
I don't think it's coherent. So this,
there's power in memory.
Yeah, but there is power. But it's, I guess the memory is sort of a very low frequency like effect.
So they would need the coherent stack.
You can do either. The thing is, if you have the phase, and I guess with the memory you would, because it's something that's happening after the merger, and with these loud events, you know when it happens. But I'd say you could use either. If you have some information about the phase, sort of when exactly this effect starts, then you could do it coherently. Otherwise, it would just have to be some kind of power. But I think this is the paper by Yan, by Chen, and his collaborators that you were talking about. I think they were thinking about
last coherent. Last year.
I forget, but. This is more, right? You know, there are multiple ways in which you can imagine doing it. This would be ideal, but you might. And so, for the two examples that I'm going to talk about, we probably won't get to neutron stars, but for the black holes, we will have information to do coherent. For the neutron stars, it's just going to be too difficult to calculate the phases, so that will have to be power stacking. Okay, so now I'm going to sort of focus on binary black hole systems and like why they are such fantastic probes of either fundamental gravity or beyond GR physics, you know, whatever things that might not be as expected. And that's essentially this final state conjecture. And this was, again, by Penrose back in the 60s. And I actually haven't found the paper where he spells this out. So this is my sort of phrasing of what I understand. It's like a lot of the things that Penrose did, he actually didn't really publish it in a referee journal, but it's been quite influential. This conjecture essentially states the following. So imagine pure classical Einstein gravity, four dimensions, vacuum, and I'll start with some initial data that's globally hyperbolic. It could be very large initial data because we want to explore the full nonlinearity of the theory, but we don't want any naked singularities in the initial data. So regular Cauchy initial data. The question is, what is it going to evolve to? What do the Einstein equations say this is going to evolve to? And his conjecture was that generically, the final state, so when everything is, all the nonlinearities and all the dynamics is done, what you're going to be left with are a set of black holes, unbound, moving apart, and radiation streaming to infinity. And moreover,
If you have gravitational radiation going out, why is it asymptotically flat?
It's not a constant density filling the whole space. So so you start with asymptotically flat, and therefore a finite total energy. So it's not a cosmological solution. And so that's part of your initial data, that it's asymptotically flat with finite energy. There's going to be a lot of dynamics. You know, you can start with high amplitude gravitational waves that might form black holes. You know, they could then spiral in and merge, and you can have a lot of stuff happening. But when everything is settled and done, all the black holes that were bound would emerge. All those that didn't merge will be unbound, moving apart, and whatever remnant radiation was produced or set in the initial data would be streaming to infinity. So that's his conjecture about the final state. And moreover, each one of these black holes, is sort of asymptotically approaching a unique member of the Kerr family of solutions. And of course, I think it's kind of obvious that it isn't the No-Hair theorem, but just to remind you of what the No-Hair theorem is. In this, for the mathematicians, I should probably put this in quotes. on the other hand, I think this is actually very close to being proven as a mathematical theorem in GRO. There are a few little technical caveats, but it really is close to a theorem. In any case, what it says is if you look at a single sort of stationary black hole spacetime, so all asymptotically fast stationary black holes are uniquely described by a member of the Kerr family. But notice there's nothing about dynamics in the no-hair theorems. And so if you just looked at the no-hair theorems by itself, you say, well, what is the consequence for black holes in general relativity? You've come to two sort of broad conclusions. One is either, you know, they set some measure zero and of no astrophysical significance. Essentially, that solutions with horizons in relativity are an artifact of assuming stationary spacetimes. The other conclusion, which is what turns out to be correct, and this is sort of the final state conjecture essentially applied to black holes, is that they're actually universal dynamical attractors. That once gravitational collapse happens, so the field equations are becoming singular, generically horizons form about them, and they uniquely asymptote to curve. But notice that this conclusion requires the dynamics of the theory. And if we say we want to test, you know, strong field gravity where the gravitational collapse happens with GR, this isn't useful for gravitational waves because there's no gravitational radiation. I say that black holes just, they don't radiate. So presumably with the Event Horizon Telescope, I think you could sort of honestly say you could perhaps be testing the no-hair theorems, but with gravitational waves you're not, you're testing dynamics. And so the dynamics of the theory is crucial.
What is FCS?
Final state conjecture, did I get the acronym? Alpha type FCS or FSC, final state conjecture, sorry. Okay, so how does this apply to binary black holes and why is it so significant? So essentially what this is saying is that, you know, binary system inherits, you know, this uniqueness property essentially. And so it's saying, like, so prepare a binary, you know, there's some, you know, caveats here and some technical assumptions, but it's sort of prepare a binary black hole system in sufficient isolation. What it's saying is that the entire future evolution of the space-time, not just, you know, the parameters of the binary and the remnant, but the structure of the space-time exterior to the black hole, the gravitational wave, everything is essentially described by this small set of numbers, the numbers that are needed to specify each of the two Kerr black holes and the orbit. And so then why this is an opportunity to test, you know, relativity is, now say you measure a binary merger with high signal to noise. So high signal to noise implies that there's a lot of information in the signal, so a lot of numbers, here, say M, but what this is saying is that fundamentally binary black hole mergers are simple in the theory. There really is not that much information contained in there. And so if you can measure a lot of information, much of it must be redundant, and so that can be used to test this conjecture. And so, you know, if you find out that there's more information than predicted by relativity, that means that one of the assumptions that went into this must be wrong. So either, you know, general relativity isn't correct, you know, perhaps the environment isn't as pristine as what you might assume. For example, what Avi and collaborators suggested with a core collapse might produce a binary in the center of a star through fragmentation. That would be a case where we usually don't expect for stellar mass black holes that the environment would have any effect. But that's one example, for instance, when the environment would come into play. Something else must therefore be wrong. So it's because in relativity, binary black holes are such simple systems, that's sort of the opportunity for using it to test gravity or to test the assumptions of the conjecture. So just a little bit of motivation. So why, you know, so I'm even more focused on just the gravity side. So why doubt general relativity in this regime? Well, I think one is just basic scientific inquiry. We're not necessarily doubting it, but we haven't yet tested general relativity in the dynamical strong field regime. Well, at least the first tests are now coming through gravitational waves. I mean, you might say, well, general relativity, classical relativity, it's a scale-free theory. So, you know, if we know something about the theory, you know, say, around the solar system or the binary pulsar, you know, strong field gravity that LIGO's going to be showing us isn't going to teach us anything new. And that's correct in general relativity. So the perihelion precession of Mercury is going to tell us more about the Schwarzschild solution than gravitational waves will. But that's, of course, if relativity is correct. We don't know that. I think dark energy and dark matter, you know, whether it really is a gravitational problem, that's an open question. But I think this, the fact that there are these big mysteries and the evidence for them largely comes from, you know, their gravitational effects. suggests that we might want to be a bit suspicious about gravity, especially in those regimes. And the dark matter is not necessarily a strong field phenomenon. Dark energy, in a certain sense, is, in the sense that on the evolution of the universe on scales of the Hubble radius is really strong field, in a similar sense to gravity around horizons of black holes. If generativity isn't correct, there might be a scale at which it's incorrect. So it's not necessarily that we'll see something at horizons or black holes that will tell us something about the cosmos, but who knows? Another reason is, of course, we know general relativity isn't the ultimate theory. Now we have the Einstein field equations, we have the left-hand side equals the right-hand side. The left-hand side is classical geometry. The right-hand side is matter, which we know is fundamentally quantum. It makes no sense putting an equal sign between them. Of course, the usual arguments are, well, that's not going to matter except when we get to Planck scales. But then there have been some suggestions, especially based on these firewall arguments. Some people suggest that this might change things on astrophysical scales.
The firewall advocates, of which I'm not one, are not arguing that anything changes outside the black hole, that there would be any signal of it. There may be a very small number of people who are suggesting this. One shouldn't characterize the...
Okay, so perhaps I should take sun to some very small fraction of
some
fire.
Very small.
Very few proportions.
It gets said a lot. I don't think it's a strong motivation
right.
For...
So since we're asking about this, when you say strong gravity, you kind of mean extreme gravity, right? You
don't mean just from a classical general relativistic perspective. So in some sense, the...
So you just mean like non-linear gravity.
Right, the non-linears have become so strong that singularities do fall. And, cosmic censorship holes, they're clothed by horizons, but it's essentially that classically the geometry is becoming singular. Of course, if cosmic censorship holes, we can't probe it beyond curvature scales of the horizon, but that's on the strong field, what I mean by strong field. Okay, so a bit of motivation, whether it's, science is not about a belief, but I think general relativity is going to be correct by astrophysical analysis, but still, we should test it. And, there might also be exotic compact objects, hairy black holes. I don't know, there are other weird suggestions like gravistars and things like that, which are strange, but still, I think this offers an opportunity to test it. So, interestingly, the way that I've sort of described, using this final state conjecture about there being too much information in a high SNR event, that's already present in this first detection that LIGO made. Let me just describe you on the results that LIGO published. So this is the famous first detection, the merger waveform. And so for this system already, you can sort of divide the data up into the pre-merger and the post-merger and say, can we, just from the pre-merger signal itself, can we estimate the mass and the spin of the remnant? And similarly, just from the post-merger, can we estimate the mass and the spin of the remnant? And with this particular system, you can. So in other words, you come up with two estimates of the mass and the spin. From a data perspective, they're independent, but of course, to come up with the estimates of the mass and the spin, you need the Einstein equation. So they both use the Einstein equation. So it's the data plus the Einstein equations. Essentially, it's from the in-spiral. You measure the parameters of the progenitor, and then the Einstein equations tell you what the final mass and spin is. From the post-merger, it's essentially the ring down. And from the decay and the frequency of this, you can invert this to the quasi-normal mode frequency of the ring down. And that's where these two estimates are. And this is the difference between these two estimates in the mass and the spin normalized to the maximum possibilities. And you see it's consistent with GR. It's not yet a very accurate measurement. This is the entire range allowed by relativity. So this is essentially the first decimal measurement of the strong field. But this is essentially... I think the first direct evidence of this final state
conjecture
is
correct. Can I ask a question that we're actually seeing closely at the data this way? So if you go to the peaks, it looks like the projection or the reconstructed is always like a little bit more than relativity. Is that true? So look at the second plot on the left.
Yeah.
If I look at the gray, it seems like it extends beyond the red consistently at the extreme.
Just in case, it's actually the sort of the error bars that encompass it, so it actually does, there is some gray above and below the peaks.
Okay.
So Yes, yeah, so the red is one numerical relativity waveform, and the gray shaded areas are these wavelet reconstructions, and so that's just the error bars in the reconstruction. Okay. And how many for time? I guess it's 5 minutes left.
Yeah.
Okay, so. I'll skip the neutron star stuff. Let me just get to the punchline for
you. Can take another 5 minutes. So.
Okay. Yeah. It'll take me 5 minutes to explain that. Okay. So this is sort of the first test. How can we improve this? How can we like shrink these error bars? Well, one obvious thing is just wait for higher SNR events. So eventually there might be a 250, and so they might shrink by a similar fraction. Another thing is to find additional pieces of data that give us initial estimates of mass and spin. So that's essentially adding extra dimensions to this figure. And one obvious way of going after it is these higher order quasi-normal modes. So this remnant black hole, so here, what you're seeing here in this part of the signal is the sum of all the quasi-normal modes that are excited. There's an infinite family of them. The dominant one is the L equals M equals 2 quadrupole moment. And that's essentially 90% of this signal. If this is GR, that's the L equals M equals 2 mode. But the higher modes are there. They have different frequencies, different decay constants. But measuring if the frequency and decay constant of any one of these modes, you can invert it to exactly the same mass and spin of the final curved black hole. So if you can measure multiple of these quasi-normal modes, each additional mode that we can measure will give us an extra estimate of the final mass and spin of the remnant. So I guess the promise of these quasi-normal modes in some ways, to test general relativity. And if the higher LM modes, they probe smaller length scale features around the light ring of the system. So that's sort of that would be a nice thing to go after, to look at smaller scale features of the geometry around the black hole. The problem with there are two sort of main problems with these higher normal quasi-normal modes in mergers for measuring them. One is that as you go to higher L and M, they decay much, much more rapidly. So the L equals M equals 2 is the least damped quasi-normal mode. So any one of these modes that are present, at least in GR, they decay very, very rapidly. The other problem is in the kind of black holes that LIGO is sensitive to, so comparable mass black holes, the subleading modes also excited with much smaller initial amplitude. So essentially, the next subleading mode is about a factor of 10 lower in amplitude that's excited. So they're excited with much lower amplitude, they decay much faster. And so estimates suggest that you probably need an SNR 200 event or higher to see the next subleading mode directly. So again, this sort of gets them back to like why might you want to stack events? Well, if this final state conjecture is correct, every single black hole merger is going to have quasi-normal modes. It's going to have whatever its full spectrum of quasi-normal modes. In 5 years of LIGO data, perhaps we'll be lucky and there will be an event like this. But I think it's very likely that even if there isn't such an event, there might be a dozen events with signal to noise of 20, 30, 40, 50, like that, like the first one. And so can we somehow combine them to go after the next subleading mode? And so this gets back to your question. Well, this is just take three black hole mergers, post-merger signals. This is the L equals M equals 3 mode. So the leading one, the quadruple mode, is a factor of 10 larger than this, so we're just looking at that. And this is sort of predictions from numerical relativity simulations of what for these particular cases, this is sort of an effect of spin and mass. You can see they're completely underlined. But the thing is, I think it was in the previous slide, but I guess this is an important point where I say why the final state conjecture is so powerful to binaries. So usually if you think of black hole spectroscopy, you just measure the frequencies and invert them to get the spin. So that's something, so you could do that in principle. But if you have a binary merger, and so with all of these signals, we'll see the late stages of the in-spiral with very high SNR in LIGO. And what the final state conjecture is telling us is not just what the frequencies and what the complex frequencies of these modes are, but for a given progenitor, it's telling us what all the initial amplitudes and all the initial phases of these modes are. So it's giving us all of that information. And therefore, if we have a high SNR in spiral, we can estimate what they should be to a pretty high degree of accuracy. So we know what the initial amplitudes and phases are, and so we can sort of shift them and before we do the stacking. So we can align, so we're going to target a given sub-leading mode, so the 3-3 mode in this case, align it based on the prediction of the initial phase and amplitude, and then we're going to add them. So this is sort of before and after alignment. So to get this coherence stacking, this is what we want to do.
So, I mean, the relationship between the modes with different LMMs are very complex. So what is the algorithm for the scale, for the rescaling and aligning that you do that you try to ensure you're not screwing up the relationships between the modes?
Right. So we that's what we just go. In this case, we're targeting one mode at a time. So a given frequency, and so the other modes, when we do this rescaling, yeah, they are going to be there, but they're not going to overlap. At least if we, at some point there will be some overlap in frequency space. But for example, L equals M equals 3, that's not going to overlap significantly with any of the other modes. So this scaling completely messes up the alignments of all the other modes.
Okay.
But we're not going to worry about that because we're just going after this mode, and we're going to sort of filter out the frequencies that we're not interested in. So the idea would be every mode that you think might be there, you redo the analysis targeting that particular mode.
Do you also need spatial information to stack these events together where the event actually happened in the sky?
Sorry, no. So the localization, that's going to give sort of uncertainty in the parameters of the system, which will give some uncertainty in what you estimate the initial phases to be. But right, so you need everything, as much information as you can about the in spiral, you know, the parameters of the binary, the relative orientation between LIGO and the source, and you know, degeneracies, noise, etc. That will introduce some uncertainties in this phase alignment.
But it's more than just phase alignment, right? Because you're changing the frequency of those waveforms.
Yes. So phase and frequency. So yeah.
With respect to the frequency, isn't there a Doppler effect due to the kick that the black hole, the remnant, gets after the merger? So you need to know also that speed.
Right, but that's going to be quite small. Even you know in these so-called right. You can imagine, you know, at some point if we're adding very, very high signal to noise events, that will start to be important. But again, that's also something that's uniquely predicted. So that will be in the final state conjecture. So whatever the kick is, that will be there, and you'll be able to put that in if you have to, but I think it will be a pretty small effect.
So can you imagine for a fixed mass black hole, the quasi-normal modes all have the same real part but different imaginary parts?
No, they're all different.
Even for fixed mass?
Yeah.
Do we expect to distinguish? Is there hope to measure more than just the leading one?
Yeah. Yeah. So again, if there's a single event SNR 200 or more,
yeah,
we should be able to get several of the sub-leading ones. And I actually have a figure showing what we might probably the next four are in range, or if we have the order 10. Ones like this GW1509-14, we might be able to stack to go after them. So I think there's pretty good hope within, once advanced LIGO reaches design sensitivity within a few years, I think we will have a few quasi-normal modes, whether it's from the lucky loud event or some kind of a stacking thing.
Mm-hmm.
Can I just understand the numbers though? So if you, like the leading mode is like, how much bigger is the amplitude than these sub-leading modes?
About a factor of 10.
So does that mean you need 10 of these things to stack up to compete? Because you have to, I mean, the background...
It's the square root of 10.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you need 100, 200.
Yeah, so do you really... Yeah, so that sounds worrisome.
So if LIGO was at its design sensitivity, that would be worrisome. But for example, this to GW1509-14, if that had been seen by LIGO at design sensitivity, it would have been close to an SNR-100 event. So I think, you know, if we have like 3 or 4 SNR-100 events, then
so you really have to believe you understand signal to background extremely well so that you can pull out these small signals.
Yes.
Underlying.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. And I should say, I'm not in LIGO, I'm not a data analyst. And when I give this talk, if there are LIGO data analysts, they say, you can't do this, you don't understand the noise, it's not Gaussian.
Okay.
And
yeah,
I say,
that's
details.
That's
I'm a theoretician.
Yeah, just even a step further, like people
are
skeptical. So it's
yeah, so I guess what I'll show you is the results from a mock study with very simplified assumptions about the mergers and purely Gaussian simple noise. So this is perhaps the ideal best case. Okay, so again, let me just skip the details, but right, so there's the thing is, right, so we based on adding sort of parameter estimation uncertainty. The thing is also when we scale the stuff, we're adding scale detector noise. So there's a whole bunch of things that are problematic, but so it's assuming that, again, this is the very clean theorist version, it seems, at least as a proof of principle, it seems promising. So this is a Monte Carlo study of sort of 100 one-year advanced LIGO runs using their most sort of recent published version of what the binary black hole merger rate is. And this is saying the SNR, so going after one mode, the 3-3 mode, what the SNR is for the single loudest event in each one of these 100 years and sort of binning histograms. So we're imagining that if we see the merger, you know, let's say we can lower the threshold for detection, say, to 5. So let's say 5 is detectable. So what this is essentially saying is that typically, given these stuff, we expect that there's a 30% chance, essentially this orange stuff, that in a single event, LIGO will be able to see the next sub-leading mode. On the other hand, with these things, if we do the stacking, we sort of essentially shift things. We almost get a factor of 2 in SNR for the stacked signal. And essentially, you know, for these assumptions, that means we'll almost be certain that we'll see a stacked signal. Well, again, to take this with a grain of salt, this is probably the optimistic thing, but I think it's sufficiently, you get a sufficient boost in SNR that I think this is worth investigating a bit more. So the last thing I want to say then with the quasi-normal modes, and then I'll just skip the neutron star stuff and go to conclusions, but this I think was a recent paper by Lionel London, and he just at the grade, like, what is the SNR of the sub-leading modes for this GW150914 event? And it's just saying essentially, okay, the error bar is large, but roughly the 2-2 mode that I showed that you could sort of see essentially 90% of the signal, you know, that was detectable. So LIGO did see that in this initial thing. And you can see it's not just the 3-3 mode, but they're really, you know, so in this study, there are 4 modes that actually have comparable signal to noise, perhaps a factor of 10 smaller. So the promising thing is, you know, if you wanted to sort of test relativity by going after additional modes, it's not as bad as thinking, you know, every additional mode that we're going to have to go to, we're going to have to need like a factor of 10 in SNR or a 10 in event rate. I think once we cross this threshold, there's going to be the next sort of subfamily is going to be within reach. So I think it's quite promising. You know, in the next 5 to 10 years, we'll very likely get, you know, a set of 4 or 5 sub-leading modes. Okay, so if it was optimistic thinking we could do stacking with black holes with neutron stars, it's even more, so it's perhaps good that I'll be skipping this. So the conclusion, the final set conjecture, it's nothing new, but I think thinking about by the binary black holes themselves sort of being these simple systems with which you can test GR is a very powerful concept. But there's, you know, if you just want to stick to quasi-normal modes and the linear ring-down analysis, you're missing a lot of the potential for understanding GR. It really tells you that the uniqueness properties of black holes is inherited by binaries, and everything about the binary black hole merger is just as simple and can be used to test strong field gravity. I guess there are many other ways in which you can think to perhaps try to stack stuff, perhaps post-merger neutron stars, but I'll stop there. Thank you.
I want to understand this final state conjecture. You're not going to stack all binaries, right? You're going to kind of classify them so that they are comparable in some sense, and then you're going to stretch or whatever and stack them. At least this is my understanding. So my question is, in this population of binaries or merged objects, how many parameters do you need to describe that? Is it just mass and spin, or do you need viewing angle? Do you need the progenitors? You know, what kind of systems came to make this guy?
Right. So with the binary black holes, so if you assume that it was in a relatively pristine environment, so ignore some of the unusual astrophysical environments, then it's just the spin vectors. So you need the vectors with the pre-merger, the masses, the orbital parameters, and you, in principle you do need the relative phase of the orientation.
Okay, so all of that would go in, and then what do? You will take a subset of systems that are more or less similar in this multi-parameter space.
Yeah, and actually, or so with focusing on binary black hole mergers, essentially you can use all of them. There's no, you don't really have to make any cuts. What naturally turns out is, so all the events that you will have, they'll have different masses, different spins. Probably the biggest difference where you want to make cuts is in signal to noise. There'll be some very low signal to noise events. You don't want to add them with equal weight. And so what it turns out with, like with this diagram, so it's actually like coherent stacking, and gives like root n. You know, there's hundreds of events, in these samples, but it turns out that what you're not getting square root of 100 or square root of a few hundred. It's really just that there are a few loudest things that dominate. So you really only it's sort of naturally you're just stacking the few loudest. But at least with black holes, it doesn't matter what their masses or spins or the progenitor systems were, because of this conjecture.
That's where I'm lost, right? Because it seems to me I can make a final black hole of 30 solar masses, spin 0.7.
Yeah.
But I can do it in many different ways. I can start with non-spinning black holes of some mass, some mass ratio. And it seems to me that this final object, of course, its normal modes are the same,
right,
independent of where it came from. But how much I excite each mode,
right,
2-2 versus 3-3, that must depend on the previous history.
Yeah. And so that comes from like how accurately can we measure the parameters of the binary from the in-spiral signal. And it turns out with the ones that make the cut that essentially add most of the stack signal, they're very loud events.
Okay.
So SNR is 50, 60, 70. So you actually get estimates of the progenitor parameters quite well. There's degeneracy, and that's where the biggest uncertainties of the progenitors, but you actually do estimate that.
I see.
And actually, perhaps I'm saying something about, like, with neutron stars, okay, there's no protection of their uniqueness properties. They're not going to be unique. But there you actually do have to make cuts in the sense that, so we were thinking, let's assume that there's a hypermassive remnant that survives for a while and has some F-mode oscillations. Can we at least stack the predicted F-mode frequencies? But there, so you have to assume an equation of state. Based on the mass of the system, you'd expect some of the heavier ones will promptly collapse to black holes, and some might be suitable for it. So there you'll have to actually make a cut based on what you think might be with black holes, at least for all of them where you see the in-spiral and you can measure the properties of the in-spiral, you can use that.
So you must be assuming something with the properties of the noise, because you don't just have the baby, you have the bathtub water in which the baby, and you don't want to throw the baby together with the bathtub water. So the question is, if you are stretching and modifying what you see, it's a sum of the noise plus the signal.
Yeah.
Is it possible to get some signal out of the noise, or it's absolutely clear that because of the random phase of the noise, you will not see anything from just the noise?
That's a good point. So we just assumed Gaussian noise with a particular spectrum.
And it's a good assumption for LIGO.
So the LIGO people will say no.
We want theorists, it's okay.
So I think that's the next step. So I would say this is the most optimistic. I think if you get real noise, it is going to lessen the effect. It's probably going to depend on an event by event basis. It might be, so that might be, just getting back to Ramesh's question, where you might want to have sort of a selection cut where they all have similar masses, because so the final mass, that's essentially sets the frequency, and if they vary disparate, then you're going to be shifting the noise by quite a lot. But let's say they're all around 30, 40, 50 solar masses. That's actually all in the bucket of LIGO. And then I think the stretching is not going to change things quite too much. But it might be that the detector is, I don't know, that's a very important question. I think we've got to the nice thing, we've got time to investigate this, because this is only going to start to work once we have a nice population of loud ones. And of course, eventually there will be a single individual loudest one. But I think stacking is always interesting. Even if you can measure it directly, then you can go after even more. You can stack the loudest one with a few other subgrouping ones and try and get more information. So.
Is there advantage to stacking the in-spiral signal itself and looking for deviations from the merger?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, we haven't looked at it, but it would be the same idea because it, and in a sense, right, the in-spiral, I think probably the most interesting place is actually the merger ring down. That's where things are most non-linear, where you might expect to see any deviation most strongly. So that's like how do you stack that phase? I think the quasi-normal modes, because we have analytic estimates, and actually, I think there's one problem with the current that way of thinking is that these mergers are not excited in a linear fashion. Or the remnant is not excited linearly, and you actually have to look at the non-linear aspects of the quasi-normal modes, but in principle you can do it. And likewise with the in-spiral, they can, perhaps there the best way to approach it might be to follow the post-Newtonian type expansion, in the sense that you can expand the waveform in the set of distinct frequencies or powers of the orbital frequency, and that might be, if you sort of get the right basis where you can scale things and add them, in principle you should be able to as well.
So in this plot, I just wonder, since you didn't specify which network you're using for this plot and estimation, so just wonder, adding Virgo, which will get better measurement of phase, etc., how much is going to help for this?
Yeah, so this was not including Virgo. It was actually just using single LIGO detector. So, but yeah, I think that's a good point there. And also like some of the other questions, that with the more accuracy we can measure the in-spiral parameters, and the more we can break the degeneracies. And so to getting the initial phases and amplitudes, it will be important to assess as much information about the in-spiral as we can. And so Virgo would definitely help, and eventually if there's LIGO India and Kagra, etc., I think it will help, but we didn't study exactly how much that would help.
Okay, I guess
we should
move on. Thank you very much. For our second speaker, we have Alexey Vyorinin, who is professor of theoretical particle physics at University of Helsinki. And his research focuses on QCD and other quantum field theory for systems such as the interior of compact stars, heavy ion collisions, as well as phase transition in the early universe. And today, he will tell us about neutron stars as lab for dense QCD matter.
Thank you very much for the introduction and also for the kind invitation. It's really a pleasure to be here. So indeed, I will be talking about basically what we can learn about the properties of dense QCD matter from different types of neutron star observations, and this is sort of from the perspective of a QCD theorist. The main reference of this talk is this recent paper by Emily Annala, Tyler Goda, Alexi Kurkela, and myself, but of course I'll be showing results from many other papers as well. In which almost all references will be can be found from this paper.
The laser pointer doesn't work.
Thanks. So the background in this kind of research is of course clear. So we all know that when a normal hydrogen burning star comes to the end of its life, there's a certain mass range where the life of the star ends in a supernova explosion, but the mass of the remnant is not large enough so that it would collapse into a black hole, but rather the end product will be a gravitational collapse to a neutron star. And neutron stars are really remarkable objects. So they are very compact, with radii of the order of 12 to 13 kilometers, as I will explain pretty soon. And yet they can contain stuff up to two solar masses. So they are incredibly dense, and in particular, deep in the cores of neutron stars, the density of matter can be many times as large as the nuclear saturation density, which is, roughly speaking, the density of atomic nuclei. So you have probably heard these words many times, that neutron stars are unique laboratory for strong interaction physics, but this really is true. So there's no Earth-based collider where we could study this kind of matter where the density is maybe even up to 5 or 6 times the saturation density. But neutron stars really provide a macroscopic astrophysics laboratory for.
With two solar masses, they are just two Schwarzschild radii in size.
Yeah,
which
yeah.
is quite remarkable.
Yeah, yeah.
Just twice the size of a black hole.
Yes, yes, indeed. So what are these objects then like? So in short, when you look inside a neutron star, what you have is a hydrostatic equilibrium, which is the result of a competition between two forces. So of course we have gravity trying to make the star collapse into a black hole, and then we have the pressure of QCD matter, sort of the Fermi repulsion, plus then a contribution from the interactions of QCD that tries to prevent the star from collapsing. And in GR, this kind of an equilibrium state can be described via these Tolman-Oppenheimer-Volkoff equations, which are two first-order coupled differential equations, ordinary differential equations for the mass distribution, as well as the energy density and pressure, all as functions of the radius of the star or the distance from the center of the star in a non-rotating approximation. So clearly, in order to close this system, we need some more information in the form of the equation of state of the matter that neutron stars are composed of, and given a unique, well-defined equation of state, so a relationship between the pressure and energy density, we can then go on and simply solve these equations and obtain one well-defined, unique mass radius curve on this MR plane. And of course, this works the other way around as well. So if we had infinitely accurate mass and radius measurements of several stars, we could somehow trace this MR curve and then do a reverse engineering of these equations to obtain the equation of state. But this is really wishful thinking, that we would have sort of one-to-one mapping already, because if you look at current sort of state-of-the-art equation of state of nuclear matter that are on the market, and then you plug them into the TOB equation, what you find is that the MR predictions are all over the place. So the uncertainties are really, really humongous. And for this reason, it's pretty clear that from the point of a particle theorist or QCD theorist, what we really need to do is try to derive from, in principle, or if possible, from first principles from the QCD Lagrangian, the equation of state of dense, strongly interacting matter in the limit that is relevant for neutron stars, and that is relatively or very cold and dense matter that is locally electrically neutral and in beta equilibrium. Now, somehow the big open questions then clearly are, first of all, can we do this? Can we actually somehow solve this particle physics challenge, derive the equation of state, and then predict what is being seen in different types of neutron star observations? Or if not, can we then maybe take the observational data from, for instance, gravitational wave observations and mass and radius measurements and infer the QCD equation of state? Or in the long run also, can we answer this sort of holy grail, this big question in this field, is there actually quark matter, deconfined quark matter, to be found in the cores of neutron stars or not? So these are basically the questions I will be addressing in this talk. But let me start, even
is
though
there,
I'm...
Is there anything yeah. approaching a consensus on what one should expect?
This is exactly where I'm getting to. So if you mean...
I mean from the theory point of view.
Regarding the last question, or just in general?
Can QCD theorists predict neutron?
OK, Okay, so this is the
not
topic
the
of this talk.
But just
I'll first talk about measurements, and then I'll talk about what we know from sort of the different types of QCD calculations, really first principles calculations, and then I'll try to combine these two approaches. But indeed, I'll first just very briefly introduce the different types of observational data we have on neutron stars. So first of all, I should mention that we already have several dozen mass measurements of individual neutron stars, some of which are already quite accurate. And the most important thing that we can learn from here is the fact that there exist two solar mass stars. So basically, these two data points here are fairly recent measurements of the masses of individual stars using the so-called Shapiro delay technique, and they both point to masses which are very close to two solar masses. And what this means is, if you recall this figure, is that we can, just based on these two measurements alone, we can go and throw out all those equations of state that lead to mass radius curves where the maximal mass is less than two solar masses. So these sort of mass measurements alone are very useful. Then, of course...
But how does Shapiro time delay tell us whether it's a black hole or a neutron star?
So we typically know... So these are systems where we know that we have a binary sort of neutron star white dwarf pair where the neutron star is a pulsar.
It's a pulsar.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. So then radius measurements, they are... I won't be going to any details regarding radius measurements, except just to say that they are... sort of traditionally more complicated, but lately there has been a lot of progress, in particular in radius measurements using the observation of X-ray emission from stars. So one approach is to look at thermonuclear explosions in binary systems where a neutron star is accreting matter from a white dwarf, which then leads to a thermonuclear explosion and X-ray emission, and then the cooling of this kind of an explosion then leads to, in a fairly complicated way, to estimates on the masses and radii of the star, of the neutron star involved, where the sort of uncertainty in the mass direction is huge, but the uncertainty in the radial direction is only of the order of plus minus 500 meters. And then there is this famous NICER mission, which has already been launched to the International Space Station. This is, of course, very much an artist's view, but anyway, the idea is to do X-ray pulse profiling, and the promise is that we will have the radius of one single star whose mass we know accurately to be about 1.8 solar masses to roughly plus minus 200 meters accuracy very soon. And this might not sound that impressive, this plus minus 200 meter accuracy, but I myself, for instance, started working on neutron stars like about 5 years ago, and then the radius, accuracy of radius measurements was plus minus 2 kilometers. Now we are at plus minus 500 meters and soon at plus minus 200 meters, so this is quite remarkable progress. But then, of course, I couldn't give this talk without also mentioning this great discovery of gravitational waves by Largo and Burgo from last fall, where they saw gravitational waves from a binary neutron star merger. And again, just mention the different types of potential inputs regarding from which we can learn something about the properties of the neutron stars involved in this merger. So first of all, if you look at the gravitational wave data in the inspiral phase, then one quantity that you can at least estimate rather precisely are the tidal deformabilities of two neutron stars. And as I'll explain soon, this is a fairly good measure of how compact the stars are, basically what their radii are. Then there's the electromagnetic signature that that was observed together with the gravitational wave event. And finally, in principle at least, we should also be able to observe a ring down pattern after the two stars touch each other. But unfortunately, in the case of this merger that was seen last fall, the frequency of this ring down part of the gravitational wave data was too high in order for LIGO to actually observe.
During a disruptive phase of the coalescence, of, would you expect to see neutrino flux from beta decay from the...
So, I expect so, but I'm probably not the right person to answer.
We can see neutrinos only from our galaxy. We cannot see... In supernovae, these are the best sources. We can see only out to perhaps 100 kiloparsecs.
But there would be an emission.
There would be, but it's not detectable because neutrino detectors are not sensitive.
So all these three inputs would certainly be very interesting topics. But for the rest of my talk, I will concentrate only on one of these, which is tidal deformabilities. So tidal deformabilities is basically a measure of the susceptibility of the form of the of a star to tidal forces. So if you have a star that's immersed in an external gravitational field where there's a non-zero quadrupolar component, then the tidal deformability basically tells it's a coefficient that's derived in a linear analysis. It basically tells you how big of a quadrupolar component the star's own gravitational field obtains when there is a quadrupolar component in the external field.
Sorry, why can't you get a dipole? You can't get it.
From tidal?
Tidal.
What do you mean by that?
Why don't tidal forces cause a dipole moment?
Well, when you expand YLMs, the tidal force, there is a... I mean, the dipole is a pump.
So, again, I'm certainly not the right person answer this, but somehow from the point of view of somehow my talk, the important thing here is that this tidal deformability is a parameter that that does affect what is measured by gravitational wave detectors in the inspiral phase, and the what LIGO actually observed was a sort of a non-detection of this tidal deformability effects. So what LIGO was able to then set is an upper limit for the tidal deformability or tidal deformabilities of the two stars, and then this constraint can be given in many different ways. Maybe the simplest way is to say that for a 1.4 solar mass star, the tidal deformability defined in a dimensionless way has to be less than a certain number, about 800 at the 90% credibility level. And at the same time, this is a quantity, the tidal deformability, that we can easily compute if we know the equation state of the matter that this star is composed of. So then this gives us one very interesting constraint for the equation of state.
The fact that you're talking about credence and priors suggests you're using a Bayesian analysis. How do you pick your priors?
So this is something that... this is an analysis of LIGO. This is not our analysis. So this is something that's discussed in the original LIGO paper. So anyway, this was just a brief summary of what kinds of data there exist. But now let me go to the QCD part of the talk. So what do we know sort of from first principles calculations in QCD, and then can we maybe constrain our results based on these observations? So, in short, if you go inside a neutron star and you start from the surface of the star and go deeper inside, then all the way up to the inner crust of the star, things are in control. The equation of state is, the computation of the equation of state is a nuclear physics problem, and everything is quite sort of accurately known up to the inner crust, where we get close to the nuclear saturation density, at which point the system is really, really already composed of neutron matter with some density of protons and heavier nuclei and some electrons. And at that point, things become a bit complicated. One needs to start taking into account the nuclear-nuclear interactions and in a systematic way. And where we are today is that the equation of state shown here in the form of the pressure as a function of core chemical potential offset by 1/4 of the baryon chemical potential of iron 56, so the most stable nucleus, we have an accurate equation of state roughly up to one saturation density, and around this neighborhood sort of systematic errors start to grow, and at 1.1 saturation density the systematic errors in the sort of current state of the art equation of state, which is from the group of Achim Schwenk in Darmstadt, are about plus minus 24%. So you can see just from this picture that we are far, far, far away from being able to really describe neutron stars from first principles. So if this kind of an effective theory setup that's sort of at least in the as close to a first principles approach as one can have in nuclear physics, if this is sufficient only to roughly the nuclear saturation density, but we would like to go somewhere around maybe five saturation densities, then this is clearly not good enough.
Do you entertain the idea of strange quark matter at all?
Yes. So this is one thing I have studied. I'm not going to be talking about stable strange quark matter here, but actually the next thing I am going to discuss is the fact that we know that at asymptotically high densities we do have quark matter. We do have actually free flavor quark matter at already densities of the order of a few dozen times the saturation density, and this is of course something that one can then approach from a completely different angle using asymptotic freedom. So like I just said, we know that asymptotically this curve, the equation of state, has to approach something that's extremely well known, that is the equation of state of a system of free quarks, which is a trivial quantity to compute. But this knowing that there is this asymptotic form is of course not enough, because we don't know how this curve approaches this and how fast and with what kind of rate.
And the center of star, which was on the previous transparency,
yep.
Where is that? Oh.
Yeah. So this is sort of this is far away from this sort of low density.
So
region.
It's just in the worst spot.
It's exactly it's in the worst possible
worst
spot.
From a theory
yes.
Point of view.
Yeah. And this is somehow this is why this topic is so complicated. So we have these very interesting but very complicated densities, roughly sort of one saturation density to maybe 10 saturation densities, where we have absolutely no sort of non-perturbative tools available to tackle this system. Lattice QCD doesn't work, and we could of course do all kinds of model calculations, but there are no first principles techniques.
This is
why doesn't Lattice QCD work?
There's this famous sign problem. So it's not only that lattice QCD doesn't work in this limit of sort of zero temperature and high density, but as soon as you leave the sort of zero chemical potential axis on the phase diagram, lattice QCD starts to suffer from a sign problem. So you can't do Monte Carlo
simulations. You need oscillates or something.
Yeah. And so basically what you can do is try things like Taylor expansions in chemical potentials around mu equals zero, but this is sort of getting to the zero temperature high density regime is very, very far away at the moment.
In principle, we're interested also not just at zero temperature, right?
Sure. But this doesn't make this sign problem any easier, unfortunately. So to add to this, the naive expectation is that weak coupling methods are not really useful in this region. So there are not that many things we can do. But I would still argue that weak coupling methods can be of at least some guidance. So we have a long history in the in heavy ion physics in trying to describe the properties of quark gluon plasma that can be probed in heavy ion collisions from doing complicated sort of free some perturbative calculations of things like quantities like the equation of state. We know that the prediction of free some perturbation theory, this yellow band here, so this is the pressure as a function of temperature for QCD. This is in nice agreement with lattice results that are available in this limit from something like 2 times the critical temperature or pseudo-critical temperature onwards. At zero temperature and finite baryon chemical potential, we only have this perturbative calculation, which is from a trivial computation we performed about 10 years ago, this sort of state-of-the-art result. Here we don't have lattice QCD, but we have there's no reason why agreement with the sort of true, correct answer would be any worse than in this high-temperature case. So what we can do is we can simply add here these perturbative lines, and then we will immediately see the reason why I've had this vertical dotted line here in all of my pictures. The reason is that the uncertainty in the perturbative equation state at this point around 2.6 GeV for the barium chemical potential or around 40 saturation density is as large as the uncertainty in this nuclear physics result at 1.1 times the saturation density. So this is really where we are today. This is if you are only willing to trust first principles calculations and you don't want to resort to phenomenological models, then we have quantitative control of the equation state to roughly the saturation density, and then again from something like 40 times the saturation density onwards.
It looks like this slopes.
Yeah, you are ahead of me all the time.
I was going to ask that, but are we guaranteed that this will be a monotonic function?
Look at the scale. It goes from 1 to 1,000.
Yeah.
That's okay.
Yeah. But, yeah, so most importantly, this is a log plot. So here, So one way of thinking about this is that here we have 24%. Uncertainties, plus minus 24% here as well. So if you just kind of naively connect these with one line, you will have large systematic error. But this is nevertheless something that I'm going to do. I'm not going to do.
Question, does physics tell us that it has to be a monotonic function?
Yes, because
it
cannot
go up and down.
Yeah, dp over d mu. So the derivative is basically the walk number density, and that can be negative. But anyway, so this is exactly what I'm going to do. So I'm not going to do models. One thing we could do is also number
kind of
density.
Phase
I mean the sort of number of baryons per Fermi cubed. I mean that can't be a negative number.
Oh, the slope is.
Yeah, the slope is number density. So what I'm literally going to then discuss is the possibility of just interpolating between these two limits in the most general way possible, and kind of try to ask the question, do these astrophysical observations that I listed in the beginning of my talk, how much do those allow us to constrain the possible behavior of this quantity in between? So let's look at this approach. So of course, if one is going to interpolate between these limits, that has to be done in a very systematic way. And there are many different approaches one can try. What we have chosen is to divide the density interval between sort of one saturation density and 40 saturation densities to several pieces, assume that we can approximate the equation of state in each sort of subinterval by this kind of a so-called polytropic form, and then just place many different intervals next to each other and require that the matching going from one interval to the next, going from this nuclear matter equation of state to the first polytropic interval, from that to the next, and so on. This is always smooth. Both the pressure and number density are continuous functions of the chemical potential, with the possible exception of one point where we would allow a first order phase transition. And then we would, of course, require that the result is somehow thermodynamically consistent, and for instance, the speed of sound can't be larger than the speed of light. So this then results in this kind of a band.
Why are you assuming that? Because there are well-known perfectly stable models of perfect fluids in GR that have superluminal speeds of sound.
So I'm now talking about the speed of light in vacuum.
Yes, there are.
So you want to...
Because
you cannot transfer information fast enough.
Yeah.
But it's not clear that
everywhere.
I will write down for you an equation of state for a perfect fluid that has superluminal speed of sound.
But that's just unacceptable, though.
Yeah,
I will
win
a lot of money at the race.
Yeah, I don't think we want to
stock market
want to go there.
Make fibers out of this material.
Yes. I don't think I can construct them. Just write it down.
Okay, so with this caveat, we we limit ourselves to subluminal equational state, and then we notice maybe a bit surprisingly that while sort of having two intervals here is the minimal requirement to actually be able to mesh these two limits, then going from two intervals to three already almost exhausts the space of possible equational state. So we have gone to four tropes, but going from three to four is already a very small change. So anyways, this is somehow the way we are if we don't impose any astrophysical constraints. This is the result of tritropic interpolation, where we assume now that there are no first order, there's no first order phase transition, which actually wouldn't reflect in the size of this clouds at all. So this is also something we have checked. So these are clouds that are composed of almost 100,000 individual equational state that are constructed by varying all these polytropic parameters in here. But of course, the interesting question is now, how does this look after we impose different astrophysical constraints? So let's start from the two solar mass constraint. So let's simply drop all those equational state that lead to MR relations that don't support a two solar mass star. What this then means is we simply throw out this sort of light green or turquoise part of the MR band, and maybe more interestingly, we end up throwing away this part of the equational state band. So physically, what this means is the equational state can't be too soft at low densities, because if the equational state is soft at low densities, then the radius and also the mass becomes of the stars becomes rather small, because the stars are susceptible to gravitational collapse into a black hole. So good, this was very simple. Then next, what we could also do, and what we have done, is to implement these LIGO constraints. So LIGO, the constraint that LIGO gave for the tidal deformability, tidal deformabilities of the two stars that were involved in this binary neutron star merger, from there one could deduce, as I already said, that lambda for a 1.4 solar mass star should be less than 800 at 90% confidence level, and similarly one can also, even though they don't give this number, but one can deduce from their 50% contour that at a 50% confidence level, lambda of a 1.4 solar mass star should be less than 400. So then what one can do is simply compute the tidal deformability of a 1.4 solar mass star for each equation of state that is listed here. And what that then results in can be seen here. So here the red band is completely ruled out by the LIGO measurement. And because the tidal deformability would be more than 800 here, and then this region here, in this region, lambda is larger than 400, and this green region would then only remain if we actually knew that the tidal deformability of a 1.4 solar mass star would have to be smaller than 400. So clearly this is a very significant constraint, and one can understand somehow this, again, what's happening, or what kinds of equations of state are being ruled out from the fact that what the tidal deformability limit actually says is that this kind of a upper limit for the tidal deformability, what that's saying is that the radius of the stars can't be too large. And the radius of a neutron star is large if the equation of state is very hard or very stiff at low density, and therefore this constraint, lambda having to be smaller than 800, really rules out the most stiff or hardest equation of state at low density. So then we can go on. We could implement radius constraints next, and here we haven't. What we did for the fun of it was to sort of ask the question that what would happen if there was really a significant improvement in the current radius limits, because there's not a huge impact from the current ones, but what if the noisier result they'll say that the radius of 1.4 solar mass star has to be 12.25 plus minus 0.25 kilometers. So again, we can easily implement this constraint in our set of equation of state, and what then comes out is this band in here, which is the most narrow at this 1.4 solar mass point, because that seems the way we kind of arbitrarily decided to enforce this constraint of ours.
So basically what you're getting, if you go back, is just a constant radius independent of mass. That's the preferred region,
right?
In this purple thing.
Constant radius, true. More or less, yes. That's
fairly. Which is interesting.
Yeah.
How can the radius be constant if you change the mass?
Of course, this is not an exact result, but sure, that's, I think, a conclusion that has been kind of uniformly seen already for a while, that sort of very vertical mass radius curve seems to be favored. But anyway, so this is somehow where we're going, and what is easy to see from here is that whenever new data emerges, it's very easy to keep on playing this game. So for instance, if we get more stringent constraints on the tidal deformabilities, we can redo this analysis and obtain even narrower bands. Or if, for instance, there was a detection of a 2.1 solar mass star, again, we would be able to just throw out a bunch of equations of state. So from the point of view of QCD or the microphysics, I would say that the main lessons from here are, first of all, that the existence of two solar mass neutron stars, and on the other hand, this constraint that the equation of state has to approach the PQCD limit at high densities, this kind of brackets the equation of state from two opposite angles. This really very efficiently reduces the range of possible equation of state, and also this existence of two solar mass stars leads to a lower limit on the radius on the possible radii of neutron stars, which is about 11 kilometers. So the fact that we can throw out this bunch of equation of state. And then secondly, what we have seen is that the tidal deformability constraint is effectively just a radius constraint. So this figure here shows the correlation between, so here each of our equations of state is just one dot corresponding to the radius of a 1.4 solar mass star and the tidal deformability of a similar star. And as you can see from here, there's a very tight correlation between these two quantities, which basically means, or which explains the fact that an upper limit for the tidal deformabilities is also an upper limit for the possible radii of neutron stars.
I'm sorry, I don't.
Yep.
You said there was a tight correlation, it just looks like a curve, right?
That's what I mean, that there is, so the tidal deformability of a 1.4 solar mass star seems to be sort of an almost unique function of the radius of a 1.4 solar mass star, even though this region, so forget this inset, this is not so important here, but this is, this region in here is composed of the order of 100,000 different equations of state. And this, a priori, if you don't think about these qualitative arguments, there's no reason why this entire plane wouldn't be filled. But this is really, we have an almost single curve on top of which all these data points collapse. And this is what I mean, that
by this tight correlation. Only on the radius,
yes,
not on
yes.
The
because
yeah.
The tidal effect depends on density,
yes.
Mean density. And
exactly.
The mean density for a given mass is a function of radius,
yes.
Cubed.
Yes.
So this is probably 1 over r cubed kind of
thing. It's not exactly r cubed. I think it was r to 7.5 was the best fit, this yellow
okay.
curve. So there are some non-trivial effects here. But anyways, this more or less leads me to my conclusion. Sorry for going over time a bit. So in the beginning of my talk, I phrased these three sort of big open questions that we are trying to address in this field, and I hope that I've sort of more or less convinced you of these answers. Can we predict QCD theories? Can we predict neutron star measurements? No, clearly we can't, at least not yet. However, I think that there's a very interesting challenge in here, exactly in this no man's land between the nuclear physics regime and the PQCD regime. And for instance, I would say that this is a very nice challenge for people doing holography. This is something that Paul and others, this is something that the EDCFT conjecture maybe one day will teach us something about, because what we really need is a non-perturbative pool to access strongly coupled quark matter and very dense nuclear matter that is not suffering from the lattice sign problem. Then can we infer the QCD equation of state from observations? Well, we can't really pinpoint the equation of state yet, but I would conclude that we are well on the way in this direction. In some sense, astrophysicists are really beating us QCD theorists in the race for the equation of state. And well, can quark matter then be found inside the stars? This is a very difficult question. I don't have the answer, but I think that this kind of progress that I've been sort of showcasing here, this is leading us in that direction. So once observations...
Actually, can I ask you, it seems like it almost leads you in the opposite direction, though, because you're saying it's rather insensitive.
Well, yeah. So once observations are so sensitive that... become so sensitive that we can really... that there is a... That these calculations become sensitive to whether there is a jump in the number density with some non-zero jump, whether there's a first order transition with a latent heat of a couple of hundred MeV over Fermi cubed. I think we are not there yet, and we probably won't be there in a few years, but eventually that's of course the hope.
I don't see how you do that. I'm just confused.
Yep.
It seems like you have this really narrow range of predictions.
Yeah, so what one of course would hope is that so the reason why in this calculation we did not consider first order transitions was that the sort of size of this overall cloud of equation of state, which is the quantity that I've been showing to you, that doesn't really increase if we allow for first order transitions. But now if you imagined that if we really knew one unique curve here, then we would be able to do this reverse engineering. So this is very much work in progress, but I hope that soon enough we will be able to answer these type of questions. Thank you.
You are running late, so maybe one quick question. Yes.
So yeah, you talked right at the end about a possible phase transition.
Yeah.
So in those plots, when you're looking at pressure versus chemical potential, this will correspond to a change of slope. Is that what? And which way will the slope go?
So there's going to be a jump in upwards.
So it becomes steeper.
Yeah.
But if you look at all your constraints, the curvature is like this. Whereas you're saying the first order phase transition would make a jump the other way, right?
Yeah.
So it's almost ruled out, it seems.
No, by no means. Here actually, this is, I should note that here the pressure has been normalized by the non-interacting Stefan Boltzmann limit. These are the plots one should look at.
Yeah.
Assume that we really that the observations were so accurate that what we would have here is basically one line. There's absolutely no reason why we could not have a sort of sudden kink upwards.
How are you going to do it? I mean, even if you do this and you put a kink, it's going off somewhere.
Yeah, but I mean, then it will have to be, then it will have to sort of smoothly.
To me, it looks like if at all you're going to lose particles.
No, I mean, then it will have to smoothly curve back sort of downwards. Yeah. I mean, these are just the two limits where this curve has to end up.
Okay, I guess you will
see
you on the afternoon for these questions. Yes, thank you, our speaker.